Welcome to Boot2boom Now, the number one live streaming show, the number one live streaming entrepreneur show, taking you from bootstrap to booming. We are here every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern, and we are here every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern. We are here every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern to get your PayPal popping, your business booming, and your life and your relationships to explode.
Boom!
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Boot2boom. We are here every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern. We're here to get your PayPal popping, your business booming, and your life and your relationships to explode. And as you can see, I don't know what's going on with this camera right now. So let's adjust. Yes. Okay. Let's make sure you can see me. Let's make sure you can see my amazing co-host, Jessica. If you don't know who I am, I'm Ava Laura, and that is Jessica. Hey, Jessica.
Hi. It's half of me.
And half of me. But we're trying to give you all of us tonight, there we go. Okay?
I'll reposition myself.
It happens. Technical difficulties happen, but I think we're on screen now. I think we're looking good now, so you all
can
see
us. Yeah, we're okay. We're all right.
So welcome, guys. We're so happy to be with you all tonight. Go ahead and share this out. You're on YouTube now. Go ahead and click the link to share this out. Sharing is caring. Share it with your friends before we get into our amazing guest tonight. Also, make sure that you are in our Facebook group. Boot2boom Entrepreneur's Journey. We're on Facebook. Make sure you go ahead and join our group, and make sure you go ahead and get that resource list. That if you're in the chat, the link to the resource list is in the chat, and you want to do that because, as you see there in the chat, we have compiled over $10,000 worth of resources for you business owners. So if you're an entrepreneur, small business owner, you absolutely want to get this list. We had resources, everything from books to home study courses to live courses to conferences that we'll be talking about. You know, just different things that we know that are all about helping you to get your PayPal popping and your business booming. That's why we're here. So every resource that you can think of that a business owner needs is on that list. So go ahead and download it. And again, if you haven't looked at it in a while, take a look because we update it each week. So I'm sure you'll find something on there that, you know, maybe you didn't see a couple weeks ago and now you need it. So go ahead. Those are the ways that you can connect with Boot2boom. You can follow us right here. Get our motivational booms that come out throughout the week. Get our after booms that come out. And of course, you can join us here every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern. We're here live. So go ahead in the chat. Feel free to ask your questions. We do monitor the chat. We will be answering you. We will be connecting with you. So if you have questions for us or you have questions for our guests, we love to hear from you. And lastly, you know, if you've been under a rock, you haven't quite heard yet. We are really, really excited to be back at PNC this year. We're going to be at the Power Networking Conference here in the Maryland, D.C. area. It's actually going to be at the beautiful Gaylord Hotel. in Maryland, in Oxon Hill, Maryland. And if you haven't been, let me just say this. If you are a business owner, if you are a Black business owner, you absolutely need to be at this conference. It is July 6th through the 8th. It is jam-packed from sunup to sundown. We will be there. Boot2boom will be there. I will actually be doing the morning meditation. And we'll be interviewing a lot of the speakers. And we'll be networking. And we'll be there showing you the ropes. So we want you there with us. We're actually going to do something special for those of you who come from Boot2boom. So we want you there. And to let you know how much we want you there, we are actually offering you discounted tickets. If you go to the website Power Networking Conference, you will see that the conference is $8.99. And it's worth every penny. Let me just tell you, it's worth every penny. You can see all the guests who are going to be there. Phenomenal. So it's worth every penny. However, because we are actually going to be there presenting, we have discounted tickets for you all. How about that? So you can get tickets from us from $3.99. So instead of paying $8.99, which again, it is worth every penny, we have tickets for you for $3.99. So if you want to get those, all you have to do is email us at boot2boom@gmail.com. And you can get your discounted tickets, and we will see you at PNC in July. So we're really looking forward to that. We want to see you live. It's great to see you here every week, but it's even better to see you live. So I think those are all our announcements for today. So before we get into our phenomenal guest, and I'm really excited to have her here. As you know, it's Women's History Month. And so we're having just a powerhouse women this month, really talking about their journey, but also sharing, you know, their uniqueness and their greatness in business. And I'm really excited about the project that she's working on. And we're going to talk more about that later. So you definitely want to stay tuned for our amazing guest, Lisa Anderson. So before we get into that, let me introduce you to my amazing co-host, who I think you can fully see her now. Yes, you can fully see both of us. So Jessica is an experienced online business consultant that has over a decade in assisting SME business owners within the digital media sector. And throughout her 25 years of practice, she has worked with well-known Wall Street and Fortune 500 companies, television celebrities, healthcare providers, leading public figures, and community leaders. Jessica, or AKA Jaw, Jessica advocated wellness. She really believes that everybody has a purpose and that her purpose is here to help you. And she is really all about helping you to show up within the digital space, or these digital streets, as she calls them. So if you are interested in starting your own podcast or your own online show, Jessica is your girl. She will show you how to do that. So you can contact her at bit.ly/talk2jaw.
All right. Thank you so much, Ava Laura. And I want to introduce you all to our founder and our president here at Boot2boom, as well as my co-host, Ava Laura. So Ava Laura is an internationally celebrated intuitive consultant and life coach who takes her clients from whole to wholeness in their life, relationships, and businesses. She guides you through a powerful healing process that helps you discover helps them discover who they are, who they wish to be, and how to get there. If now's the time for you to live a freedom-focused life, detox yourself of limiting beliefs that no longer serve you, and create an unrecognizable reality, then Ava Laura is the guide you've been waiting for. Get your consultation today by emailing her at Ava Laura at AvaLaura.com.
You say this every week. Like, you should know it.
Okay, so what happened was, it was two Ava Lauras, right? Right next to the at sign. So I was thinking, okay, anyway. You know how you go at somewhere, you know, because everybody says the at sign for when they want to tag someone in. So anyway, back to our regularly scheduled programming. So today, our topic, we're talking about co-working spaces and why it's so important for you to have a support system and someone that you can speak to that's like-minded individual, as well as networking, right? And why that's so important in your business. So Ava Laura, I want to bring her into the conversation just a tad bit. Give us a couple of situations that you've been in or networking conferences or things of that effect. We talked a bit before the show started about conferences and things of that effect, and we talked about PNC as well. But why is it so important for you to have an actual space where you can come to and receive support, network, and all that good stuff?
You know, I mean, we talk about it a lot here on Boot2boom, and, you know, if you've been watching us from week to week, then you know so many of our guests have said it. You could go to last week, you could go to the week before, I guess have said it, and that really is talking about the power of our relationships. None of us would be in business today without relationships. If there's no people, if there's no customers, if there's no clients, there's no consumers, there's no business. And a lot of that comes from the relationships that we not only build, but that we nurture and we cultivate, that we really feed into. And so networking is really the first step to that. And I think that a lot of people, we tend to miss that point. When you're a solo entrepreneur, when you are a small business, a lot of times we tend to get in our bubble. And we kind of forget about the outside world, especially if we work from home and especially with social media. So we kind of feel like, well, if we're on social media, we're connecting with people. But there's nothing like that human connection, seeing people face to face. And so even though we're talking to you here, like, we love doing Boot2boom. We get to be here with you every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. I'm excited about PNC, where I get to see you all in person. There's nothing like that connection. And I can tell you, I was actually... just talking to a woman. I actually had a meeting with a woman this week, and I was telling her that with women, one of the things that I found out, now, I mean, I work with men. I get this question all the time. Yes, I work with men, but the majority of my clients are women. And women, we like to touch you, feel you. We got to feel your vibe. We got to feel connected to you. So women, when we network, it's like, oh, let's go out to lunch. Let's go out to brunch. Let's go out and get coffee. It's not enough to just have a phone conversation, but I want to see you. I want to feel you. So that networking, it's key. It's the lifeline to your business.
So I absolutely agree. And I think just to follow your idea a bit further as well, I think the more conversations you have, the more money you're going to make. So as long as you continue to have conversations, then your income will start to increase and your revenue will start to increase. So you have to think of it that way as well. The more people you speak to and let them know what you do, and also to reciprocate as well, the more people you come in contact with and you know what they can do, then they can help you out as well. And so it's really a give and a take, is, you know, back and forth. And like you said, following your idea further, you don't know someone until you actually like meet them in person and feel, like you said, their energy. I think live stream has done a lot in that respect. Yeah. Whereas before, where we had to have conversations and it'll be recorded, or, you know, you come into, remember back in the day, I don't know how old you guys are, but I'm pretty old. Back when they had tape recorders, when we had tape recorders, right? Or you had to call someone's phone number and leave a message and wait until they got back to the phone to play the recording on an actual cassette tape that they had to listen to and rewind if they wanted to listen to it again. Well, now we have FaceTime, right? That kind of makes that obsolete. We can just go on FaceTime and see someone and kind of feel their energy as well. Text messages in real time, so on and so forth. So I think that digital media, like Ava Laura said, while it does have its limitations, there is definitely an upside to it as well, and something that we can definitely tap into to feel that energy if we can't. Like Ava Laura and I, she lives all the way. Where are you? Maryland. Maryland.
All the way.
All the way. I don't know why I was saying all the way. I think I was thinking Leon. I'm thinking Leon lives all the way in the UK. I'm rapping again. Okay, but anyway. But seriously, like, we, you know, this will be our first time meeting. I'm gonna just let y'all in on a little secret. This will be our first time actually meeting in person. So I get to say, oh, wow, you're totally not the way I thought you was gonna be. No, I'm just kidding. I think I've kind of seen Ava Laura's highs and lows over the past couple of months.
I am exactly as I seem.
Yeah.
What you see is what you get.
Right? And live stream kind of opens that door too. Like, and like Ava Laura said in the past, we've had our meetings that have been, have gone there. So definitely we've been able to build a relationship over, media. We haven't been able to physically meet, but still I can feel her energy and know the type of person she is, you know, what makes her laugh, what makes her cry on the opposite end of that as well. All that good stuff. And she can see mine as well. So definitely check that out. Check out PNC. Definitely make sure you're there in person. I'm sure we're going to be live streaming like crazy as well if you can't make it in person. But definitely, if this is something that your budget will allow, this is something that you definitely need to take advantage of. I just read a study earlier.
Your budget will allow. Make your budget allow it.
Well, you get a tax deduction. So, I mean, really, truthfully, it should allow it. But
about that.
Yeah. That's all I need to hear. I was like, check. But anywho, following that idea further, just make sure you're getting out there and you're communicating with others and you're around like-minded individuals, because it's so, so important to your business in order for your business to flourish and sustain. All right. So let's go ahead and check out who our sponsor is today. I don't even know because I didn't take a look yet. Oh, I know who it is. Can you guys guess? It's Ava Laura. Ava Laura, crowned by Ava Laura. Surprise, surprise. So let's see if I can do this without getting tongue-tied. Get your regal, sophisticated, luxurious head wraps at crownedbyavalaura.com. DMV and women in surrounding areas, attend the Crown Tea, where you'll learn all about the healing benefits of tea, how to wrap your hair, all while dining on premium tea and a dessert bar. So you can register now by going to bit.ly/crowntea. Oh, I'm so excited for you that bit.ly was available. That is too cool. As you guys know what I'm talking about. Somebody in England that use bit.ly? Bit.ly? I know somebody in England right
now. That would be bit.ly/crowntea UK.
And she probably went to it like, some black woman took it? I cannot believe it. Anywho, who do we have as our wonderful guest today?
So we have an amazing guest, and I'm sure she's going to be talking more about this concept, really, of not just networking, but really being with like minds and the importance of that for small business owners, in particular women. So I'm really excited to have her on tonight. So we have the amazing Lisa Anderson. Now, I want y'all to hear this, okay? Because this woman got credentials for days. She is a certified public accountant, CPA, a certified leadership coach, workshop facilitator, serial entrepreneur, strategic business advisor, and virtual CFO with a novel Transformation Solutions LLC. Woo! Y'all thought I had some stuff. All right. She focuses on helping business owners get beyond the plateau and position for growth. She executes award-winning techniques and solutions to help small, minority, and women-owned businesses scale and transform their business from I to we. And we talked a little bit about that, how a lot of us are just kind of in our own bubbles. It's just us, right? Especially starting out. And with the heart of helping a million small businesses achieve $1 million. I want y'all to hear this. Lisa wants to help a million small businesses achieve $1 million in revenue and beyond by the year 2022. And her mission is to help companies optimize their mission by maximizing their growth. Please join me in welcoming Lisa Anderson. And we can't hear you.
Let's try this again.
There you go.
Hello, everybody. Good evening, ladies. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for having me here. I appreciate you. I was just sitting here wondering, trying to figure out who that was you were talking about a minute ago.
Who this woman?
And let me just say, you lady, you guys are off the chain. I'm sitting here in the background. That's why it was on mute, because I was cracking up. There's nowhere in the world I could have stayed behind the scenes with all that was going on. Your audience would have been like, who in the world is that in the background laughing like that? But that was me.
You guys have been before.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, we have.
So yeah. Thank you so much for being here. And, you know, before we get into, you know, all the projects that you have going on and what you're doing and how you're really helping small businesses, we want to hear from you. Why did you become a business owner?
Oh, that's a loaded question, quite honestly. I think, first of all, it was in my DNA, you know, not necessarily because my parents were entrepreneurs, but somewhere along my journey when I was in school, especially when I was in high school, I had the idea that one day I wanted to be a business owner. I'll tell you that growing up as, you know, really young, I thought I wanted to be a doctor. until I took my first biology class in high school and I realized I don't like blood. I don't like cutting things open. I don't like any of that. So a doctor was simply not in the question. So instead, I kind of found my pathway into accounting, and I absolutely fell in love with numbers. I still love numbers to this day. I believe the philosophy that numbers tell a story and they don't lie. And so when I took my first accounting class, I didn't know this at the time, but I fell in love with entrepreneurship. I fell in love with business. And I realized that at my 20 year high school reunion, when we went back and pulled open the newspaper that we write about ourselves, and I had written that I would own a successful accounting firm when I came back to my 20 year reunion, and that was absolutely true. And I don't remember writing that. So I have to say that somewhere along the way, God planted that in me, and it's just been a part of my DNA ever since.
Wow. So, but you said, so your parents were entrepreneurs as well?
Mm-mm, they were not entrepreneurs. So I didn't know anything about entrepreneurship. I mean, I know everybody's heard of Robert Kiyosaki and his concept that, you know, you don't hear about owning businesses, building businesses. What you hear is to go to school, to learn, to get a good government job. And in fact, that's what, you know, I was told, is to go to school, learn, get your degree. And my mother made me get my first government job. Which then ultimately landed me in a community serving the government contracting space. But she didn't know that that's what she was doing at the time. But no, I didn't have entrepreneurship in my DNA through my bloodline. I didn't have that. No.
So that there was a method to the madness. So it was implanted in you. And so even though you weren't aware, but you were very in tune with what your purpose was, even at that age. So how did you like take all of that? So you took your good government job and your training and all of that. How did you take that into then, okay, actually doing just that, opening up your own, your CPA firm?
Yeah, absolutely. So as I mentioned, my mother took me one day to, back in the day, back then, you could walk straight into Office of Personnel Management, and you could get a job right away with the government. And so that's what she did one day. She told me that good paying job that I had at People's Drug Store, which is now CVS, making $3.35 per hour, which I thought I was rich and very happy with that. She said, it's time for you to get a real job. So she took me to the Navy Department, and I started working in the government contracting community, working around budget analysts and just working around a lot of numbers. And through that process, I was also working on my undergraduate degree at the same time in accounting. Through that process, I started to learn the government contracting community and working with a lot of small businesses. And over the years, I saw that A lot of small companies struggle, especially in that space. There's a lot of regulations that they have to adhere to in order to win and keep those contracts. And there weren't a lot of resources out there to help them. And so I made it my mission to learn the requirements so that I could teach companies how to follow the requirements. And then one day I did start my business. So it's kind of, you're right, it's a journey. It's something that was planted in me. I will have to say I didn't plan it that way. It found me instead of me finding it. And I just went with it.
Wow. That's pretty amazing. And even though you knew that, you still had a process that you had to go through to get to that point. You didn't just jump into starting that business, but there was preparation involved. Yeah. And really being able to do that.
Yeah. So there was preparation. I started working on the concept of entrepreneurship, I would say about 3 years or 4 years actually before I launched my business. Mm-hmm. And that started with me working kind of a side hustle. At that time, I was doing tax returns for family, friends, and friends of family and friends. And so that was the beginning of what I called then Delaney Accounting Services, which then ultimately became Deander Accounting Services, which is now 20 years old. But there was a process. But I'll tell you that I did jump into starting the business full time. We had a family emergency, and I was working for a pretty unreasonable employer at the time. And I was pregnant and I needed to be home with my family, and they forced me back to work. And so I decided that day or around that time that they forced me back to work, that it was time to start my business. I left that company. I went to work for a really small company where I tried to become a consultant. They told me, no, we want you to be a full-time employee. I said, sure, I will be a full-time employee for you for 1 year. And I took that 1 year to build or prepare for building and stepping into my business full time. And I did that 1 year to the day.
Wow. So what was that preparation? What did you do?
I started working on my network. I made a listing of all the people that I knew, all the businesses that I had encountered, that I had come in contact with. The employer that I worked for was an accounting software company, and I had a lot of contacts with a lot of business owners, a lot of organizations that ultimately could become my customer one day. So I built a reputation around that. I worked with graphic designers to start building my brand, my logo. I started scouring the job ads. That's how I actually got part of my first contracts, was responding to job ads. Companies that were looking for accountants, I sent them a resume. And when I interviewed with them, I told them that I was a consultant. And some of them accepted that. And they signed a contract with me.
I love it.
So those are the types of things that I did to prepare for my exit into from corporate America into working for myself.
I hope y'all heard that, because that was right? A boss move right there. She straight created her own position. She said, no, no, I know you want an employee. I'm not an employee. I'm a consultant. Now go ahead and sign this contract for me as work as your consultant. That is boss.
It was a bold move. I mean, we're talking about 1997 entrepreneurship and jumping out into starting a business wasn't a big thing. And the economy wasn't positioned for me to actually do that. And people weren't prepared for a woman, most specifically, to walk in and say, yeah, I can do exactly what you want me to do, and I can do it better than the average employee. And by the way, I don't want to work for you. I want to be a consultant for you, and here are the benefits. And quite frankly, I didn't know anything about marketing. I didn't know anything about sales. I didn't know anything about messaging. I didn't know how to talk to people. I just went, I knew what I wanted. And yes, I was afraid of getting no. Yes, I was afraid of getting the door slammed in my face, but what I wanted more than anything was to start my business. And so I kept pushing until I got yes, yes, and yes.
And that's where like the internal knowledge takes place, right? Because we always talk about we need to learn, and you know, some, and like you said, I didn't know anything about sales. Oh no, you knew how to sell. You knew exactly how to sell. And that's the whole thing. Sometimes I think we place those limitations on ourselves because we want that particular degree or certification or even someone else to acknowledge that we have it within us. But really, truthfully, we already have it and it's always been within us. Yeah. So we don't need that particular term to be placed there or the really education for it to say, oh, yeah, you fit the criteria for X, Y, and Z. So I think that's great. And I think you're, like you said, if you know what you want and you just put the things in place in order to get it, then you will have it. So you were like interview jacking instead of news jacking. You were interview jacking.
Yeah.
So, and that's unheard of, especially in that time and being, you know, and I'm just going to be real. Everybody knows I say it anyway. I say what I want to say anyway. Being a Black woman in that time and saying, I'm not going to work for you. Oh, but I will take your money. That's... Man.
Yeah, you're right. That's basically what I said.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll take your money, but I'm not, no way in heck I'm going to work for you. However, I can't do the job. And, you know, here's what I can do for you. And then having them say, oh, okay. So you must have said it with such an amount of confidence in yourself and the ability to do it that you were just like, you know, hey, cool. Let's make this, let's do it.
Yeah. My mission was to convince them that they didn't need somebody to come in there full time. It was going to cost them a lot of money for them to maintain somebody full time to do a job that somebody like myself could come in and do part time. And the other thing that also helped me start successfully with my business was, again, tapping into my network. I reached back to CPA firms I worked with in the past, other previous employers, other people I'd worked with on a team together, other managers I've had. I reached out to bankers, and they actually referred business to me because they knew the type of work that I did as an employee of the companies that they supported. They were comfortable with referring clients to me. So I will tell you, in my first year of business, I made very easily more than six figures. And I wasn't making six figures when I was working for someone else. And it's all because of that planning and preparation.
That's wow. Yeah, that is. That's especially back then. My goodness. So my next question is kind of on a personal level. How much you got I can borrow? Like, I need some investors for my...
Well, you know how it goes. Let me tell you what happened was.
So now let's move into the next
thing. Let me tell you
phase.
Something. Lisa is a sleeper, okay? She going to come in there like, oh, you know, I don't know. I don't know sales. I don't know negotiation. Before you know it, you're like, wait, what did I just agree to? What just happened?
Yeah, that's a secret weapon. Yes, it is. It does still happen that way. I will tell you that. I'm a quiet storm. Yeah, I'm a quiet storm.
I'm going to ask you after this broadcast exactly how you know. So, Lisa, tell us a bit about moving on and forward now. You are doing something with business women and supporting them. So tell us a bit about that.
Sure. So today, as you mentioned in my bio, I'm a serial entrepreneur. My first business was an accounting and compliance company. And again, it's been in business for 20 years. We celebrate 20 years. About 3 years ago, I launched a novel transformation solutions, which, you know, was a business that was shifting me to, instead of doing things for other companies, I was shifting into showing them how to do it for themselves. And so now I really work more intimately and closely with business owners to help them strategically align their business to position themselves for growth and, most importantly, to remain profitable at the same time. But as a woman business owner and as an African-American woman business owner, I know absolutely how lonely it is. sitting in the business ownership seat, sitting in the CEO seat. Number one, you can't trust everybody, although what I should say is you can't trust everybody with everything. And so as a woman, you want to be able to share information. You want to be able to communicate with other people. And it's difficult being a woman business owner and understanding that you can't do that. Because what you end up doing is operating in business outside of yourself. So that's number one. Number two, everywhere I go, and I say this all the time, everywhere I go, I am either the only minority in the room or I'm one of few women in the room. And I'm always finding myself having to prove myself in order to claim my seat at the table. And I want to be able to make it much easier for women in business, especially now that women-owned businesses are growing by leaps and bounds. There's so many of them coming into the marketplace year over year. And even though we're increasing by numbers in terms of the number of women-owned businesses that are entering the marketplace, our earnings aren't increasing at the same rate. We still don't make as much as our male counterparts. We're still questioned. We still have to struggle and fight for our seat at the table. We still have a hard time establishing effective relationships and building a really good circle of people. And so what I wanted to do was to create a space, a community, really is what it is, for women business owners to get together and just be themselves. Number one, to really get back to what you said, Ava-Laura, earlier, to get back to communicating with one another. Yes, we do have the digital era. We have things like this, you know, YouTube. We have the Facebook Live. We have a lot of those things, but still, there's nothing like being able to sit round table and touch and feel. Being able to really look into the other person's eyes and understand exactly what they mean when they say certain things. One of the challenges I had in business, and I would have to say is probably one of the biggest, I don't want to say failures or mistakes, but I think it's one of the largest things I didn't know how to do effectively was how to vet. How to really make certain I was making the right decisions on who I was letting into my organization, into my circle. I prayed on it. I remember sitting in my conference room on a Saturday afternoon all by myself praying, God, please teach me how to make better decisions because there's something wrong here. I was having problems with certain customers. I was having problems with certain employees. I was just having problems. I had a huge problem with a subcontracting vendor, and it didn't have to be that way. And so he taught me the lessons that I needed to learn in order to properly vet and bring in the right people, forming the right partnerships, the right relationships. And I want to be able to teach other women how to do the exact same thing, but in a community where we can openly work together and learn from one another.
I love it. I love it. And, you know, you had an event Friday, which you could talk about really, which was your grand open or open house and talking about those relationships. And you said something important that I want to touch on. Two guys that you introduced me to, and you said, these are your strategic partners.
Yeah.
And so I want you to talk a little bit about that. What is a strategic partner and why is it so important for businesses to have that?
Yeah, absolutely. That great question, because that's another thing that I work with companies on, business owners on, is to strategically align themselves with the right people. A strategic partner is someone that you trust and they trust you. You work in and around the same community, serving the same markets, maybe not in the same way, or it could be the same way. But you both add some type of uniqueness to the market that's a little bit different than the other, but you help one another. You refer business to one another. You can lean on one another. And the strategic partners that we had at our grand opening are people that have been in my circle for years. And I can count on them and they can count on me. And I don't have to worry about competition. That's the other thing I want to be able to build is a community where we break down the barriers of competition and we really collaborate together. Ultimately, what I want to do is form a large consortium of women-owned businesses that go after larger opportunities together. And that's what strategic partnership is all about. Business is really about building teams. It's not about doing things yourself. That's something I had to learn how to do. My husband, for example, knows how to delegate. He is a master delegator. If I say, honey, I need you to do this, he's going to say, sure, I'll do it and go hand it to somebody else. He's quick about that. But that's something I had to learn.
I actually have to say, from experience, your husband is good at doing that because I had that experience at the event. He said, yeah. I was looking for, she had a lot of great food. I could not eat it all, but I was not going to let it go to waste. So I said, I'm taking a plate home with me. He said, oh, I think they got foil. Why don't you ask so-and-so? Go over there and see if they got foil. And that's what he did. And sure enough.
Yes. He's not going to ask for direction, but he's going to give some direction. But you know, that's something that I value in him and that I had to learn how to do. I had to learn how to delegate. But really business is all about that. If you want to grow from I to we, you want to grow your business beyond yourself, you've got to get comfortable with delegating. You got to build a team. That's really how we go far and wide in business, and strategic partnerships and strategic alignments is a critical component to that. Yeah.
Wow. You said a mouthful right there. Business is about building teams.
Yep.
That's powerful because I think that, again, particularly most of us start off at least as solo entrepreneurs. And so I don't think we really get that. We don't really understand that concept because particularly, you know, for a lot of us, it's all about building brands and the brand is around us as a person.
Yeah.
So we're really not thinking about the whole concept from the beginning that business is about building teams. And that's something that I had to learn too, because when I started, nobody was talking about this stuff. So I had no clue.
Yep.
I really had no clue. It was just like, okay, I'm open and I'm going to find a way to advertise and market and get clients. Nobody said, well, you need to be strategic. You need to build these relationships. You need to build teams. Nobody was talking about this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So it took me years before, you know, I was even aware of that. And I'm like, oh my goodness, I could have been doing this all this time.
Absolutely. And if you start with that end in mind, the day when it comes time to make that shift is easier. So if you start your business with the idea that it's not just about me, one of the things I hear a lot of entrepreneurs say that I battle every day with in terms of, you know, trying to get them out of that mindset is small business owners have to wear many hats. No, you don't. You wear many hats because you choose to wear many hats. You don't have to wear many hats. You can bring in a team of people that don't work directly for you. You can outsource components. You know, I love the way that you have Boot2boom structured. You have a team that's working with you through this process. And so, again, you choose to wear many hats, not because you have to wear many hats. And if you have to wear many hats, it's because you didn't structure it right from the beginning.
Yes.
You got to start with that mindset.
And I had to learn the hard way because the first season, it wasn't a team. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And now I'm like, oh, my God, what did I do without them? How was I was stressed out.
Absolutely.
I really was. And I was like, I don't see how I'm going to do this and do everything. And this has been, I mean, oh my God, it's just been such a wonderful experience. It's been a lot easier balancing this with all of my other roles. Because people are like, how do you do all of this?
Yeah.
Teams.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah. Multiple hands get it done faster and quicker. And you can do more with multiple hands. And, you know, you got to get out of mindset that is all about me. Yeah, the brand might be about you and the business might be about you, but let's talk about that for a minute. Let's talk about the brand being all about you. It, you know, when companies start businesses, they rarely think about the day that they close. When they start, they rarely think about the day that they close. But you've got to start thinking about that from the time you open your business. Business is not perpetual. It does not last forever. It's not designed to last forever. There will be an end. And if you don't think about the end, then it will think about an end, right? The business will operate with an end in mind. It might not be the end that you had envisioned along the way. So it's best for you to consider that from the beginning. And as it relates to building a business, if you want to build a company that ultimately one day will be a multi-million dollar enterprise, you're not going to be able to do that alone. You're going to need teams. If you think about speakers, top speakers where the brand is all about them, and they're making millions of dollars. They're making millions of dollars because they have a team in the background. They have an administrative team. They have a marketing team. They have speaker coaches. I mean, there's a team that is rallied around them to help them be successful. So you got to think about that from day number one. And then if you're also building a business where you ultimately want to scale, and it's a venture where you want the marketplace to accept your team and not just you, you got to start building that from day one. Because I'm going to tell you, I started building my first business based upon me and my genius. And then the day I decided I wanted to grow up in business and shift from being a consultancy to professional services and bring in more people, it was hard for me to make this shift with my clients because all they wanted was me. Yep. That's difficult. So you got to think with that end in mind and start moving your ship in that direction from day one.
Now, how do you overcome the objections in your head? Because I hear you, you know, you're like, oh yeah, you know what? You can't work on your own. You need to hire, you need to bring on more people, but your business is your baby. And yep, you got to make sure that your baby is done right. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So it's really hard for you to give up that access to, you know, your baby when you want to protect your baby and you want your baby to grow up healthy and you feel like you're the only person that can do what it is, you know, give the baby what it needs pretty much, yeah, right? Absolutely. So how do you move from that mindset so that you can grow, you know, and move forward?
Yeah. Great question. And it's not easy if you don't have the right resources around you to help push you in that direction. And one way to get out of your head is to really build a circle of people around you, good advisors that have been where you are, that have been where you're going, that can help you understand the obstacles and help you get outside of your head. I like to say that oftentimes we serve as a CEO, and that's exactly what we are. We're their eyes and their ears. We see them, their stumbling blocks, and we tell them, no, stop. Let me tell you how you need to shift in the direction that you need to go in and how you can get there. I think the other thing, too, in terms of protecting your investment, which is what you actually asked about, is number one, you have to know what the company, what your business stands for. You have to build your foundational principles. You have to build the core values of the organization and be able to communicate that on a dime, but also use those core values to evaluate employees and team members that you're going to bring into the organization to take over the work that you've been doing. And then don't just delegate and don't just hand it off and expect that they're going to take it and run with it. I always tell business owners, you need to inspect what you expect. So if you just take that baby, right, and you hand it off to somebody, in your mind, you have an idea of the way the process should run. But you, if you never communicated that to them, if you never follow up with them, if you didn't do any form of tag ups, check-ins, then at the end of the day, somebody's going to drop the ball and you're going to be angry and upset about it. And all of a sudden, you're going to be protected again and you're going to take it back. No, hand it off appropriately. Stay in constant communication. And again, inspect what you expect. Have your values in place and make certain that everybody's operating and in alignment and moving in the proper direction, in the direction that you want it to move in. Wow. So it is a process.
What you expect.
That's right.
I'm done.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And you know, and really what's so fascinating about what you're saying, because Jessica, that was a great question, because that's where so many women struggle, especially Black women, because we really want to feel like we're in control of everything, even when we're not. But really what you're saying is that is the ultimate control.
Yeah.
Is that when you have a team of people that you have chosen, you've told them exactly what it is that you expect.
Yep.
You have put forth all the resources and everything for them to do their job appropriately, and you have chosen them. That's the ultimate control.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you don't have to do it.
Absolutely.
I mean,
absolutely.
What
right? That's
I mean, really think about that. Like that right there is like you got many hands that you have fully chosen to do what you could not do.
Absolutely. I mean, think of it this way. Think of Chick-fil-A, right? And how they manage every aspect of the customer experience. And there's so many. If you pull in into the drive-thru, there's a lot of employees in there, but they're all working in harmony. That is a well-oiled machine. And that's because they have core values in place that's properly communicated. They have processes in place that everybody follows. They check in and check up. They have internal audits, external audits. They're managing that. But here's one of the things that we say in our head that keeps us from properly putting those things in alignment is, oh, but then we're going to be micromanaging. We don't want to be a micromanager. Let me tell you something. The only person that cares about micromanagement is the person that's not doing the job. You don't ever hear the person that's doing the job properly, effectively, seamlessly. You never hear them complain about micromanagement. It's always a person that's not doing the job.
That's there is right. My tambourine. Oh, my goodness.
That's right.
Listen, you know it's about to get good when somebody says, let me tell you something. You know. Wisdom bomb on you. Let me tell you. Look,
that's what we call black coffee on this side. That's black coffee conversation.
Or we start with girl.
Yes. And so at C-Suite Elite, that's what we plan on having. Some good old-fashioned girl black coffee conversation.
That's right. I love it. That's right. I love it. Oh my goodness. That was a good one. That was a good one.
I mean, wow, you dropped so much wisdom. What other mistakes do you see small businesses make that you really because starting C-Suite Elites and, you know, what are some of the other mistakes that they make that you really want to combat? You want to make sure, particularly Black women business owners, that we don't do that.
Yeah, I think one of them is we jump too quickly. So what I mean by that is we want to make a shift. Again, we're scaling our business. Our objective is to grow from I to we, right? And then we finally get the opportunity to bring somebody on board. We're making a little bit more money that's beyond ourselves. And then we jump really quickly to pile on a lot of other things by in the name of infrastructure. That's too fast. You have to manage the process of building while managing your bottom line. Those two things have got to be in balance with one another. Building the organization and your bottom line, they've got to be in balance. And so I think that's one thing that one of the areas that I want to be able to create some impact is, let's build this, let's build it, you know, as quickly as it should be built, while also making certain that we're managing profitably. Let's not jump too quickly. I think the other thing, too, is knowing when to say no and saying no, right? We chase, as small business owners, you know, we call it the hustle, right? We are hustling. We're running after money, after customer, contract. We just running. We're on that treadmill. But we really never take the time to sit back and evaluate, is this the right opportunity for us? Does this fit within our organization? Do we even want to do that? I'm going to tell you, in my accounting business, I did start off, I think I mentioned, I started off doing tax returns. I hated tax returns. I still hate tax returns. And guess what? I don't do tax returns anymore. Why? Because one day I realized I hate this. It's not effective for me. It's not effective for my clients. It's just not effective. So for my team, it's not. So I let it go. I had some people that weren't happy about it. And I had some other people who wanted me, you know, they still try to convince me, can't you just do taxes? You're so good at this. Can't you do that? I'm good at this because that's all I do. I'm not going back to doing those things that I don't want to do. And so we have to learn how to say no. The other thing is we have to learn how to negotiate. And part of knowing how to negotiate is coming to the table, knowing exactly what it is that you want out of the deal before you get to the table. Know what your break-even point is. Know when it's time to walk away. And then negotiate to that point. You are ultimately looking to create a win-win for you and your customer. It's not just about, you know, getting or grabbing another contract and earning another dollar. Sometimes that all money's not good money. Sometimes that dollar that you bring into the business is going to be the hardest dollar you will ever make. So we have to learn how to say no when we should say no. And that's part of the open dialogue, the open conversations that I like to have with business owners is, you know, let's talk about that. You're not meant to serve everybody. And Ava Law, I've heard you say that.
Oh, you know, I'm famous for that one.
Yes, indeed.
Another lesson I had to learn the hard way. I learned it well.
Yes, indeed. Yes. Sometimes you have to learn things the hard way, but I tell you what, some things you don't.
Well, that's what we're here for. So you don't have to learn the hard way. You can listen to this and say, you know what? I don't need to go ahead and do that. Lisa already did that. Ava Laura did that. Jessica did that already. Yep. Let me make this other turn here.
Yep. And you know how we already did it? Because we have the bumps and bruises to show you. For sure.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, you touched on something else that was really important that I wanted to touch on before we end here. And that was that you don't have to struggle. You didn't necessarily say those words, but that's basically essentially what you meant. It's that you don't have to sit there and be in the hustle and bustles, like you said, the hustle of it and everything, because you're trying to meet this expectation. I know I come in contact with a lot of women business owners, males as well, same thing. But they all kind of say the same thing. I want to make like the most amount of money in the shortest amount of time. And I just want it to happen, you know, just, you know, lickety split. I want to be at six figures, you know.
Like six figures, you know, 6 months.
Yeah, there you go. You have those programs that have the six figures in 6 months, so on and so forth. So some people, they even stop working in entrepreneurship because they go, okay, I didn't make it. I didn't make what other people are making. And they start to do it at a comparison mm-hmm. thing. So they go back to work and they find themselves in stressful situations. So I just wanted you to talk to the audience out there a bit about not having to struggle, not feeling like you have to position yourself back somewhere else, you know, back into a position that you absolutely hate with a job that you absolutely hate, just because, you know, you're not at a level that you see other individuals at. You don't have to struggle. It's not necessary.
Yeah. So one thing I want to say is there is no one size fits all when it comes to business. Every single business is different. Every single one of them. They may appear to be the same from the outside looking in, but from the inside out, they are very different. Every single one of them are uniquely designed. And so you cannot compare nor build your business based upon what the person to your right and the person to your left is doing. Companies come to me all the time. They'll ask me about pricing. Well, what should my price be? And how, you know, this person is charging that, this person is charging. No, there is no this and that. You need to design your business based upon your objectives, your mission, your customers, period. Period. So 6 figures in 6 months, sure, it can be done, right? You can kill yourself trying to do it, right? You can build business based upon just a whole slew of people that are in the marketplace that you haven't tested nor vetted, and you're accepting practically anything within your business. So if your objective is to build business and then sell it quickly, that might be a good model. If your objective is to build business and build maybe a legacy or build something over time that gets you to another means to an end, my business, DeAndre Associates, was built to help me get my children to and through college. Mm. It served that purpose, but I couldn't do six. Well, I did do 6 figures in six months. I did do that, but it wasn't because I was rushing to beat myself against the clock, and I wasn't comparing myself to other organizations. I was going after business that made sense for me, and it just happened. So stop comparing yourself to the next person. You will drive yourself crazy doing that. Your business plan should be based upon your objectives, where you want to go, and the market that you serve. So I don't know if that answered the question.
No, that was fine. That's mm-hmm. perfect. Perfect, perfect, perfect.
So speaking of that, I'm curious, what do you think about a business plan?
It's necessary. It's absolutely necessary. Again, I liken your business to a ship. And without a plan, it is a ship waiting in water, just waiting for the wave to come and blow you off to the shore or someplace out in the middle of the ocean where you're going to be lost, right? A business plan will help you move in intentionally and methodically in the direction that you want your business to take you. It's absolutely necessary.
Yeah. You know, I actually had a conversation. I had this conversation a couple of months ago with someone that I rent office space from. And she was just like, when you put together, and I think that a lot of people get that mixed up. They think that if I'm putting together a business plan, I'm putting together a business plan because I want people to invest in my business. I want to go out and get a loan or so on and so forth. She's like, really, truthfully, you just put together a business plan so you plan where you're going. And it's for that reason only. Because yeah. Like someone like myself, I don't want anyone to invest in my business because I don't want to give them a piece of it. I want to keep it all for me. Yep. So I'm not going to sell any pieces in my business at all whatsoever. Yep. I don't want investors because once you get investors, then they're going to tell you, do this, do that. I don't want to answer to anybody. That's the whole reason why I started this. Yeah.
To another point on that, I think you also want to consider the fact that everybody that works with you is an investor in your business. Everybody. Your employees are investing in you. Your bankers are investing in you. Your customers are investing in you. Your strategic partners are investing in you. And they want to know, especially your employees, they want to know that there is a mission and a vision and a plan to get to the end somewhere down the road, that there's going to be a growth plan for the organization. And if they don't, if there's no plan, if you know, things change every day ad hocly, you're going to have a revolving door. It's going to be hard to maintain those investors in your business. So you need a business plan. It's not just for you to go to the bank and get money, right? It is so that you can really build a growing business. That's what the plan is for. Yeah.
I like that. Really seeing your clients, your customers, as investors in your business. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I like the non-traditional piece. Just know you don't have any shares. Just know that.
I know that's right.
Let's keep that straight. Let's just come to that understanding. That's
right. Wow. I mean, this has been awesome. You have dropped some really, really powerful nuggets. Is there anything else that you would like to share with our audience, and how can they reach you and really tap into C-Suite Elite and your podcast and everything else you have going on?
Sure. Well, I think just to really sum it up, it's really, really important to build your business in an intentional and methodical way so that you're running your business instead of your business running you. That's what the business plan is all about. That's what vetting is all about. That's what developing partnerships and strategic alignments is all about. It is building something that's intentionally going to get you to the end where you'd like to be somewhere down the line. It could be 10, 15, 20 years from now. So it's very important that you do that. And then it's also in order to establish those relationships, it's really, really important that you get back to basics. And back to basics is pick up the telephone and talk to people, right? Don't hide behind email. Don't hide behind, the text portion of social media. You really got to get out and talk to people, touch people. The whole know, like, and trust factor is real. I mean, it's real. The companies that go, that make lots of money, they're building relationships. Look at Apple. They're building relationships with all of the hundreds and thousands and millions, right, of customers that they have. They're building that relationship. So that's important. So that's what C-Suite Elite is all about. It's a co-working, collaborative community for women in business. I do also work with men, but this space, this community is for women in business specifically. And you can find more information about C-Suite Elite by going to www.csuiteelite.com. We also have a Facebook page, and then my podcast is called Plateau to Profits, and we have conversations, what I call black coffee conversations, just like we had here this afternoon, where we talk about just anything about business, just to help you grow and remain profitable as you grow the business. And what else can I tell you? Novel Transformation Solutions is my strategic planning and organizational development company. And we're at anavotransformation.com. Anavo is A-N-A-V-O. We're all over Facebook, Twitter. Recently joined Instagram, still learning that one. So we're everywhere. LinkedIn, you can find me on LinkedIn. I'm Lisa D. Anderson on LinkedIn. And that's it.
That's awesome. And just a quick question for Elite Suites. Is it virtual or just physical?
So C-Suite Elite is a combination of physical and virtual. So there is a virtual component. And as a result of our open house that we had this past Friday, I am building more levels of membership into the program. So I don't want it to be restrictive. I want to be able to help. Again, I have that lofty mission of helping a million companies reach $1 million. And so we're going to be opening up and crafting more levels of membership for C-Suite Elite. But there's both a physical component and a virtual component.
Awesome.
Woohoo! Awesome. Virtual!
I encourage you guys to definitely tap into that because it was just an awesome experience just being there Friday. And for those of you not sure where we are, we're in the Maryland, D.C. area. So physically, that's where. So if you're in the DMV, D.C., Maryland, Virginia, you can definitely tap into that as a resource physically. If not, virtual works, because obviously you see Lisa is a wealth of information.
Definitely.
So you may certainly want to consider that.
Yes. Thank you. And Ava Laura, I want to say thank you too for supporting us and for being there for the grand opening. It meant a lot. I appreciate it. I appreciate your feedback as well.
Thank you. I appreciate it. It was a great experience. I'm glad I was able to make it.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, guys, this has been awesome. I'm so excited. So I'm going to say that this is an episode that you need to go back and watch. There was some very practical, like, I feel like I need to go back and watch because I can't write stuff down and, talk to you all at the same time. So yeah. You're going to want to go back and watch this with a pen and paper and write down these notes. Seriously, you're going to want to do that. Thank you so much, Lisa, for being here and helping us celebrate Women's History Month. We're going to be back here next Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern. If you haven't already, get your discounted tickets for PNC. Email us at boot2boom@gmail.com. And just like Lisa's talking about, conversations like this, this is what's going to be going on. So you definitely want to join us there. Get your discounted ticket for $3.99. Go ahead and email us. We're going to see you next week. I'm so excited to see you all again, guys. Have a good night. We're done.
Thank you, ladies. I appreciate you. Thank you for having me on.
Good night,
Thank
everyone.
You. Nice meeting you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.